good morning, everybody. Happy Mother's Day. Good to see you on this Lord's Day, and glad that you're here. And did any of you notice that Rosalie has turned into Carolyn? Did you see that over there? And she has done a great job this morning. We're so happy that she is helping us today as Rosalie is taking the day off. When you walked in this morning, hopefully you received a bulletin. Look at it. There's a ton of stuff happening in the life and ministry of First Baptist Welcome. And I want you to be informed and involved, and there's a lot of time-sensitive announcements, so make sure that you read through all of those. There's opportunities to participate in mission. There's opportunities for our senior group, for fellowship, and you'll see even more announcements on the back concerning a blood drive coming up. It's hard to believe that we're halfway through the month of May, and then June will be on top of us before you know it in summertime, and a lot of things are going on. And so I want you to be informed and involved. One thing that's not in the bulletin, it'll be in the bulletin next week, but I'll give you a heads up, is that we're going to have a business meeting on Wednesday night, May the 24th, and we'll be talking, Property Planning Committee will be sharing some updates with us, and that'll be in the bulletin next week, and I'll remind you next week, but I wanted to give you a heads up on that. We are super glad that you're here and thankful. We have many guests, a lot of folks on Mother's Day have come to be with their moms, and so that's awesome, and so we welcome you. And if you are a guest today and you're visiting with us, we'd love to get to know you and build a relationship with you. There should be a guest card in the pew in front of you, and if you are comfortable filling that out and introducing yourself that way, we'll just drop that in the offering plate and on your when it comes around, and we won't bother you, but we will pray for you and reach out to you and see if we can help you in any way. It is Mother's Day, and you'll notice on the front here we have three different roses, and we have these here in honor of moms today. We have a red rose there, and that's in honor of everyone who's here this morning who is a mom and has the joy of being a mom. And then we have a white rose there, and that is for those who will gather with us today whose mom has passed and already gone to be with Jesus. And so Mother's Day can be difficult as you think about your mom and miss her. And then we have a yellow rose there, and that yellow rose is for all of those who will gather with us today who want to be a mom and for one reason or another have not been able yet to conceive or have gone through the pain of a miscarriage. And so these roses represent all types of moms. We just want to honor you and say thank you for your love and your influence in our lives and in our families, and what you do matters. I read about a little boy at school had a little report due, and it was a fill-in-the-blank, and it was a six-letter word that picked up things. And the answer was magnet, but he said mother. And our moms are so valuable and important to us, and so thank you for being here on this Mother's Day. Now, let's do this. Let's stand together. I know you've already been so welcoming to others, but find two or three folks that are here this morning that you haven't said hello to, and let's greet them and say good morning. Go ahead and stand, and let's welcome one another. All right, if we can gather back up together real quick. Remain standing for a moment. We've got something special we hope is going to happen with our children's choir in just a second. But before we get to that, I want us to take a moment to pray, and I want you to join me in praying. You'll notice on the screen, we like to begin our services with the public reading of Scripture. And so you'll notice these verses. Let's read these verses together, and then we'll pray and continue on with our service. Let's read this with one voice. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are His judgments, and how inscrutable His ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been His counselor? Or who has given a gift to Him that He might be repaid? For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be glory forever. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You for the reminder already in not only the warm fellowship of the saints, but in the reading of Scripture, that You are a God worthy of our praise, that You are a God above all, that You reign, that You are our sovereign, loving, compassionate God who has taken care of us, who has provided for us, who's met our needs. And Lord, our greatest need is forgiveness. You've given that to us in Jesus. And so we've gathered today to make much of You because of Jesus Christ. Thank You for being a God that is worthy of our life, worthy of worship, worthy of our all. And so it's to You that we cast our attention and that we praise today. And we ask this now in the good name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, be seated. And we have a special group this morning, a special singing group that's with us on this Mother's Day. You saw in your bulletin, you saw the lyrics to the song that they're going to sing. And so thank you. And go ahead, Tiffany. Yeah, it's great. That's awesome. Great job. Thank you, Tiffany. And thank you, girls, for leading us in worship this morning. Let's all stand together. Big Wayne's coming. And we're going to continue to sing. And you'll see the words on the screen as we begin to lift up our voices in praise to the one who's worthy of our praise.
I think we ought to give God's creation another hand. Amen. Let's all stand if you're able, and we're going to sing Trust and obey. Song, and y'all may be seated if you would. Love lifted me.
The master of the sea.
Amen. What's a good song, isn't it? A good reminder. We were sinking deep in sin, and Jesus lifted us. It's a good word. Speaking of that, we are a church committed to the gospel of Jesus and seeing our neighbors and the nations come to hear the good news of Jesus. And to that end, we give. There's a lot of things that comforts that we enjoy, like a nice room, nice lighting, air conditioning as it gets hotter, heat in the winter, a nice place to sit. But that's not why we give, to support those things. We give in order to make sure that we can be participating in the mission that God has placed upon us to be a light in a dark world. And so to that end, we receive an offering. I'm going to ask our ushers if they'll stand. Let's have a word of prayer. And thank you for being joyful and generous givers to support the mission God has given us.
Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we just come to you this morning, Lord, just praising you and thanking you for that love that you send us each and every day. We pray for all those that are hurting this morning, Lord, and we pray for the joy of mothers that we celebrate this day. We ask a blessing upon all these givers and the offering we're about to receive, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Thelma. That's such a great hymn, and I'm glad you played that this morning. Take your Bible. Let's go to Genesis chapter 3 this morning. It is Mother's Day. Genesis 3 might be seem like a strange place to go to on Mother's Day, but I want us to spend a little bit of time looking at that text. Mother's Day, as you probably know, is the number one restaurant day of the year. It beats out Valentine's Day and Easter. And so I'm going to try to commit to the second service to get them out in time for lunch, but no promises on that. If you are here this morning and you are a woman, and you don't have to be a mom, but a woman, we have a gift for all the ladies today on their way out. It's a little woman of faith. I guess this is hand sanitizer. It clips onto your purse or your belt if that's your thing. And we'd like you to have that on your way out this morning. But this is the day that our nation is celebrating motherhood. It's on the calendar, Mother's Day, and that usually involves a gift of some kind. And I hope that you have received a nice gift today already. If not, I hope you get one. Today I read about three sons who wanted to express their love for their mom and with gifts. And she was quite older, and she was living alone. A very godly woman, and so her boys wanted to communicate their love. And the first son, they all got together and they were talking about what they did for their mom. And the first son said, well, I bought mom a brand new, nice, big house. And the second son said, well, I bought mom a new Mercedes. And I know that she can't drive, So I've hired a driver that will drive her anywhere that she wants to go. And the third son said, well, I beat all you guys because I know mom loves to read the Bible. And sure, her eyesight is such that she can't read it anymore. And so I bought mom a parrot, a talking parrot that has been trained by a group of 20 monks for 12 years to recite the entire Bible. All mom has to do is name chapter and verse, and that parrot will recite the verse. Now, I got to make a donation to the monastery of $100,000 for the next 10 years, but mom is worth it. So she sent out thank you cards to her boys, and to the first one she wrote, Dear Milton, thank you for the house, but it is way too big. I live in one room, and now I got to clean the whole place. To her second son, she said, Dear Marvin, thank you for the car, but I'm too old to go anywhere, and the driver is rude. To the third son, she said, Dear Melvin, you were the only son who had the good sense to know what your mother likes. The chicken was delicious. I hope you get more than a chicken. I really do. I have felt impressed over the last month or two to start a series on spiritual warfare for our church. And I wanted to start it next week formally. But this morning, I want to talk about spiritual warfare as it relates to our families. And I want to spend a few moments just talking about the family. God created the family. It was God's idea that we exist in relationship with one another. And that relationship, the first relationship, was a family. Now, when he created the world, and if you know this from Genesis 1 and 2, if he created the world, he puts Adam in the Garden of Eden. And he looked at all of creation and he said, it's very good. And then when he's talking to Adam, he says, you know what? It is not good that you are alone. Now here's what you have to understand. Adam did not know he was alone. He's living in paradise. He has all the food provided by the earth, except for meat, that he can enjoy. Fruit, grains, nuts, he's got it all. He's got this beautiful place to live. He's got animals to keep him entertained and to, you know, play with or whatever he's doing. He has no idea that he's alone. He thought he was doing okay. He's, in modern terms, he's in the ultimate man cave. He has no idea something's missing. God walks with him and talks with him. He's fulfilled. And it was God who said, it's not good for you to be alone. And so God said, let us make a helper for him. And thus the family was created by God. It was God's idea that we would exist in a relationship known as a family. But this morning, you woke up in a world where the family, or the idea of the family, finds itself in the midst of a cultural conflict, a cultural war. Our culture, for example, the culture that we live in, has evolved, it's changed, it's shifted on its view of marriage. For thousands of years, there was a traditional, and we would say a biblical view of marriage, that marriage is a covenant relationship between one man and one woman. But our culture now has redefined marriage, and now what we have is we have something in our culture called same-sex marriage. And the question is, if you redefine marriage and marriage is no longer marriage, then what counts as a marriage? And the answer is anything, I guess, counts as a marriage. It doesn't mean anything anymore. For example, I was reading this week about a woman in Brazil. She was a supermodel, and she was having a hard time finding Mr. Right. And so she was tired of people asking her about finding Mr. Right and all this stuff, so she decided that she would marry herself. This is a true story. She had a dress, she had a photographer, she had a formal marriage to herself. And wouldn't you know it, a few months after that, she met somebody. So this is true. So she divorced herself in order to marry a guy. It's true. It sounds crazy, but it's true. And since our culture no longer holds to a traditional or biblical definition of marriage, then technically anything can count as a marriage. Where does it stop? Is polygamy now okay? I mean, the Mormons were doing that for years. What about polyamorous relationships where you have two men and one woman, or two women and one man, or three guys and two women? Where does it stop? You have this thing in our culture called a throuple. That's three men or three women that decide to marry each other. I mean, where does it end? And so our culture is awfully confused on what a family is and what marriage is. It's also confused and in a fight over gender identity. I don't know how closely you watch the news. There's a very famous pop singer, celebrity. She has 160 million followers on Instagram. I mean, she's really popular. Her name's Demi Lovato. And she shared this week that she was gender fluid. You may have heard that term, gender fluid. She says, most of the time I'm in my feminine spot, but I flow into a non-binary spot, and I just flow in between gender identities. I'm gender fluid. That's why there was an article that I read several years ago that made the claim that the worst thing a doctor can do in the delivery room when a woman gives birth to a baby is to assign that child a gender, to say it's a boy or it's a girl. This article was saying it's the worst thing a doctor can do is to say that, because the doctor doesn't know if it's a boy or a girl. That's up to that individual to decide whenever they want to decide. And it seems like every single day we're hearing stories in the news of some issue concerning drag queens or transgenderism among our kids, or men participating in women's sports, and there's this argument, a political argument that's going on whether or not sexually explicit books should be available in elementary school libraries. All of that is swirling around in the culture because the culture is awfully confused on what is a family. What is a man? What is a woman? Who are we? But it isn't just the culture, it's also the church. The church has also been quite confused on this, especially in recent days. There was a pastor in San Diego who caused quite a stir when he made a video claiming that drag is holy. And here was his argument, that Jesus comes to earth and he puts on human flesh, that Jesus is God in drag. That's what he claimed. There is a church in New York City right now that has an exhibit called God is Trans. This is happening in what people see as churches. I wouldn't call them real churches, but some people do. I'm not bringing all this stuff up so that we can laugh about it or make fun of it or get angry about it. I'm not trying to make some political statement. I just want to emphasize that you and I woke up in a world that is awfully confused and in constant conflict over issues of gender and family and marriage and parenthood and sexuality. And marriage and family, it's found itself in the midst of this cultural conflict. But the Bible tells us that the reason for this is that it's not really about a cultural conflict, it's about a cosmic conflict. What do I mean by that? Well, the Bible is clear that there are forces of good and evil at work in this world. The Bible tells us that we have an enemy named Satan who works against us. He works against the work of God. And as a result, because the family belongs to God and he created it, it's a work of God. And since Satan is opposed to the works of God, he's opposed to the family. He's opposed to our marriages. He's opposed to our identities. Now, why? Why is this the way that it is? Why is this true? Well, as Christians and as evangelical believers, we stand on the truth that the Bible is the Word of God. The Bible is our authority for faith and practice. The Bible is where we learn about who God is. He tells us the truth about himself. He tells us about his designs for creation. And so we don't believe that gender or marriage or family or sexuality is something that some culture made up. It's something that is taught to us in the Scripture. It's something designed by God. Society doesn't define those things. God defines those things in the Bible. Therefore, we don't have the right to redefine them. So when we talk about these things, here is where we start. That sexuality and family and marriage, that all of this belongs to God. And his word defines how we view these things. His word defines them for us. And you have to remember that Satan hates everything that belongs to God. And since marriage and family are also designed to glorify God, and Satan hates the glory of God, Satan is constantly trying to diminish or mar the glory of God in this earth. And therefore, your life, you were created to glorify God. Marriage is to be a picture of the glory of God. Salvation is a picture of the glory of God. Having a family is a picture of the glory of God. And because Satan hates the glory of God, he hates those things and works against them. And so in that sense, you this morning woke up thinking about a cultural war and maybe forgetting that it's really a cosmic war, that there are forces of evil opposed to you and your home and your marriage and your identity and your family. And so we see the culture wars, but I want you to understand underneath it is the cosmic war. We have an enemy who's waging war against us. And the Bible proclaims that our real enemy is not flesh and blood. Our real enemy is the devil. Now look what it says in 1 Corinthians, or Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For we do not wrestle against what? Flesh and blood. Can I just tell you, listen to me, that the president is not our enemy. No politician is our enemy. Your wife is not your enemy. Your kids are not your enemy. Your husband's not your enemy. Our enemy is underneath all of those things. See, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And this battle began in Genesis chapter 3, which is why I wanted you to turn there. And the battle began there, and it rages all through the Bible. And so I want us to look at Genesis 3, verses 1 through 7. I want to talk about some truths about spiritual warfare as it relates to your family. So look at verse 1 of Genesis 3. Now, the serpent was more crafty, more cunning than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? And the woman said to the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden, but God said, you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that's in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. But the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened. In other words, God's holding out on you. There's a reality to experience that you won't know anything about unless you taste this fruit. God's not giving you the whole picture, is what the devil was saying. He says, you'll know, your eyes will be opened. You'll be like God, knowing good and evil. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and she ate. And she also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were open, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loincloths. Now let me pull out of this text three truths about spiritual warfare and your family. Number one is this, is that the devil has a battle plan prepared for your family. Is a battle plan prepared for your family. Now, we just read the text about the temptation of Adam and Eve. Now, what's interesting is that the devil, here's the question I ask myself. Why didn't the devil tempt Adam before Eve was created? You thought about that? He could have come to Adam in the daytime. It's just Adam. He's all by himself. He's just got animals and fruit trees and rivers. That's all he's got. And he could have slithered up to Adam before Eve was created and said, Adam, have you considered some things? Have you considered some things? Why does he wait until the man has a wife? Thought about that? Because that's his strategy. That's his strategy, to attack families. That's always been his plan. Now look at chapter 2 and look what it says in verse number 15. Just look back in chapter 2, 15. And the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden. He says, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat it, you shall surely die. Now he says that to Adam. Now look at verse 18. Then the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. Eve's not even on the premises. She's not even been created. When God gave Adam the law, don't eat of this tree. So why doesn't the serpent come and say, hey, Adam, see that tree over there? I think you ought to eat of it. Why does he wait until Eve is around? Because this is his plan. His desire is to attack families. And right after the first family fell into temptation and sin, you will discover as you read the Bible that all kinds of family problems pop up. Right there in the Garden of Eden, when God comes and says, Adam, what have you done? What does he say? It was the woman that you gave me. And instantly there's marital conflict. If you go over to Cain and Abel, you have these brothers, and Cain kills Abel. Now you have this hatred in the families. When you get to chapter 4, you meet a man named Lamech, and Lamech takes two wives. And suddenly what you got is you've got this fracturing of the family with all kinds of things like adultery and divorce and infidelity and rebellion. And you see sin and how sin has wreaked havoc on the family and on marriages after the fall. The same thing happens in the New Testament. You see the destruction of sin on the family that God has created. The strongest teaching on spiritual warfare in the New Testament is Ephesians chapter 6, where Paul talks about the armor of God. But what did Paul talk about in chapter 5? Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Children, obey your parents, for this is right. And he gives all of this family instruction, and then he goes into the armor of God. That's not a coincidence, the order of things. What Paul is saying is he's saying, listen, you need the armor of God because I've just taught you God's instructions for the family, and the enemy's coming after your family. Satan's plan is to wage war against your marriage and your relationship with your kids and your extended family. Why is that? Because he knows, as one old preacher said, whoever wins the family wins the war. And so if you want to live out your Christian faith in your home, listen, if you say we want to be a God-honoring, Christ-centered, Holy Spirit-influenced family, we're going to make Jesus first in our family. We're going to make Jesus first in our parenting. We're going to make church a priority and reading the Scripture a priority and sharing the gospel and living on mission. This is going to be our priority as a family. You are welcoming and opening up your home to the attention of the evil one who wants to stop you and wants to destroy what you're doing in your home for the glory of Jesus. It's not just that you have this enemy that comes against you. You've got an enemy inside of you, your own sin nature. And your flesh will rise up in your home. It'll rise up in your marriage. It'll rise up in your parenting. It'll rise up in your heart. And so you've got this outside enemy, the devil, this inside enemy, the flesh, and both of them are working against God's glory for your family. But I want you to know right off the bat that the devil, he has a battle plan prepared for your family. And number two, I want you to see in this text that the devil's battlefield is your mind. The battle plan is to attack your family. The battlefield is your mind. Now, I want you to notice the confusion that he stirs up here in the Garden of Eden. His desire was to cause both Adam and Eve to doubt, to be confused about God's truth, about God's word. So you see this in the text where the woman, he says to the woman in verse number 2 or 1 there, he says, did God actually say this? Are you sure you heard God right? Maybe God didn't say this. And he begins to twist and confuse Eve's mind as to what God has said. He attacks our minds. He wants you to doubt the truthfulness of the Scripture. He wants you to doubt the truthfulness of God's word. He wants you to be confused about right and wrong. This is what he wants. He wants you to be morally confused about what God has said. You find this idea supported in the New Testament. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says, I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will also be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. How are you led astray? With your thoughts, with your mind. That's how he tries to lead you astray. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, he says this. He says, for though we walk in the flesh, we're not waging war according to the flesh. We are to destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God and to take every thought captive to obey Christ. Why? Because the enemy is trying to get you to think wrongly about who God is and who Christ is and who you are and what this is about. He wants to confuse you. He wants to deceive you about what God has said concerning marriage and family. He wants you to doubt God's word, to twist it, to water it down, or just ignore certain parts of it that you don't like. I was dealing with a man in my church many, many, many years ago who had graduated and was in seminary and wanted to be a pastor and was training for ministry. And we were about to hire him to join our staff when somebody called me and said, "You can't hire that man, he's having an affair." I confronted him, and it was true, he was having an affair. And I began to plead with him to repent, to be reconciled to his wife. And I was talking to him one night on the phone, and I said, "Listen, the Bible says that what God has put together, you're not supposed to tear apart. It was God's will for you to be together." And he said, "It wasn't God's will. God did not put us together." And he went on to explain that the very first date that he had with this woman, that they had been intimate, and he says that our relationship was born not of God but of sin. And I'll never forget, he said, "Whatever's born of sin will never make it." Well, I happen to know that he's having an affair with a woman. And I said, "Well, I guess your current relationship with this other woman's not going to make it either, since that's born in sin." And he said, "Oh, that's different. This is different." See what Satan does? He wants to twist your mind up to believe that it's wrong over here, but it's right over here. This is exactly what's happening in our culture. Let me tell you, we're living in a day where the culture is trying to decide what is true, and they're not looking to the Bible to figure it out. So here we come as Christians who love people, who want people to know Jesus and want people to be freed from sin and want people to have to live for the glory of God. And we say to the culture, "But the Bible says this is wrong. The Bible disagrees with you on the issue of marriage and family and identity." And then they say, "That's because you're a bigot or a fascist. You're a hateful person." And the mind of the culture has already been turned by the evil one. My son is rewatching the Star Wars movies, and we've been watching them. I went to the movie theater a couple weeks ago. They had the Return of the Jedi 40th anniversary. They had it on the big screen, and so I went to see it just to remind myself of how old I am, that thing came out 40 years ago. And the whole point of the movie is trying to get Luke Skywalker. If you haven't seen the movie, I don't want to spoil it, but you've had 40 years to see it, so I don't think I'm going to. Turn Luke to the dark side. Darth Vader and the Emperor, they plead with him, "Come join us. Turn to the dark side." He says, "I never join you. I'll never turn to the dark side." And the Emperor says, "If you won't join us, then you will be destroyed." And that's exactly where you as a Christian live in this culture. "If you won't join us," they say, "then you will be destroyed." And what the devil is trying to do is to get you to compromise and to turn your mind and try to convince you that what God said, he really didn't say or mean. And your thought life is the arena in which our spiritual battles are won or lost. It's no accident in verse number 1 of chapter 3, he says that the serpent was more crafty, more cunning than any other beast. What does that mean? In the context, the word means trickery. It means evil treachery. That he's a master at getting you to be confused about what God has said. And what Satan wants for you and what he wants for the church to do is to rewrite God's word in order to fit our sinful desires. He wants to plant seeds in your mind right now that your marriage, that you need a new one, that it's not going to work. He wants to plant seeds in your mind right now that sexual impurity is okay, that gender identity is based on how you feel. And most of all, he wants to plant this seed in your mind, hopes it'll take root, that the purpose of your life is to be happy and do whatever it means for you to be happy. He wants you to water down God's truth and to accept what the culture says is true concerning family and marriage and sexuality and every other issue that we see being waged in the culture. What his battle plan is your family. The battlefield is your mind. And then lastly, the devil uses powerful weapons in the battle against your home. He's got some weapons that he uses. And when you read through the scripture, you find that Satan has designated weapons aimed at your family and your marriage and your kids and your grandkids that he uses against your family. I'll list four of them on the screen. We'll work through them really quickly. The first one is sexual temptation. He wants to introduce your family to your family temptation that is sexual in nature. 1 Corinthians 7 verse 5 speaks to this. This temptation comes in many forms: lust, pornography, adultery, fornication, obscene thoughts, sexually explicit media. He wants to bombard your home with these things to desensitize you, to get you to believe that sexual immorality is just normal. That sexual temptation is not temptation, it's just instinct. You're just a beast acting on instinct. And that stuff is fed into your home through TV. If your kids have a smartphone, they have access to more sexually explicit filth than any of the grandparents in this room ever had access to. He's coming after us with sexual temptation. Secondly, he comes after us with unresolved anger. In Ephesians chapter 4, it talks about not letting the sun go down on your anger. And what Paul is saying is that you're not to hold on to your anger, to use it to hurt people in your family. There's a lot of homes behind the walls. There's a lot of anger. There's a lot of yelling. There's a lot of fighting. There's a lot of rebellion and disobedience. A lot of grudges held within families. It's always been interesting to me when I've gone to do a funeral and they just can't wait to be back. Can't wait for them all to gather on the other side and be with Mama once again. And they couldn't stand being with her on this side. Unresolved anger. Thirdly is insensitivity. 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 7 talks about husbands living with some sense of sensitivity towards their wife. Insensitivity leads to all kinds of marital conflict. And since the fall, for both men and women, since the fall, our greatest temptation is in marriage is to be insensitive, to be distant, to be controlling, to be abrasive, and ultimately to love ourselves first, to be insensitive to the needs of others in our family. And the fourth weapon, there's many more, is just rebellion to authority. This is why the Bible is continually encouraging children to honor their parents, to obey them, to be a productive part of home life. But the enemy wants you as a son or as a daughter to rebel against your parents, to disobey them, to dishonor them, to discount them. Now listen very carefully, church. Listen, this is true. You're going to have to make a decision for your marriage and your family of who gets to define things for you, either the culture or the scripture. Your family is either going to be ruled and guided by the Holy Spirit or the spirit of the age, and the spirit of the age is the spirit of Satan. Your behavior in marriage and in sexuality and in identity, it's either going to be motivated by the truth of the word or it's going to be motivated by the fallenness of your heart. And what Satan wants to do is he wants to move into your home, capture your mind, corrupt your kids, ruin your marriage, and confuse you as to what is right and true so that the world will look at us as Christians and say, they're no different than us. They're just as sexually immoral. Divorce is rampant. Their kids are rebellious. Their husbands are insensitive. In fact, we think we're handling this issue better than they are. Because guess what? They're already on Satan's team. Ain't fighting them on it. But if you belong to Jesus, he's fighting you on it. So what are we supposed to do? Well, part of the answer is found in chapter 3. Look at verse 7, and we'll close with this. Verse number 7, what do Adam and Eve do? Both of their eyes are opened, it says. And they knew that they were naked. Now, here's the issue. And I'll talk about this in the future because I want to talk about this verse later. But they were naked, and they were not ashamed. And their eyes are open. It says that they knew that they were naked, and now they're ashamed. Now, nothing happened in the second before they ate the fruit and the second after. It's not like they looked at each other and said, oh, we don't have any clothes. Clothes didn't exist. There's no thought that they should be wearing clothes. When it says that their eyes were opened and they knew they were naked, what that meant is they knew they were exposed. They knew how they had been seen as they truly were, that they were fallen. So what do they do? It says that they took fig leaves and they sewed them together and made for themselves loincloths. They tried to cover up their shame with man-made stuff. which is exactly what the world proposes for shame. It's a man-made solution. It's always fig leaves. It's always fig leaves, something that you can do that will make the shame go away. But God has a different solution. You're in chapter 3. Look at verse 21. And the Lord God made for Adam and for his wife garments of skins and clothed them. Man's solution is fig leaves. God's solution is a garment of skins. How did he make a garment of skins? An innocent animal was sacrificed on behalf of the guilty Adam and Eve. The innocent takes the place of the guilty. God had said, if you eat, you shall surely die. But they don't die. But something does die in the garden. Then the innocent animal dies in the place of the guilty ones, so that they can be covered with something much superior to fig leaves, with animal skins. It's a picture of Christ. Christ, the second Adam, who comes and he dies in our place on the cross, the innocent one, the perfect, spotless lamb. He dies in our place that we may have our shame covered by his righteousness. It's a picture of the gospel. And so what are you to do in this cosmic battle that you're in with your family? You have to remember that Jesus Christ has defeated Satan in his death, burial, and resurrection, and that Jesus died for the sins that you are under in your home, and that because of Jesus and what he's done for you, you don't have to sin against your family, against your wife, against your husband, against your parents, against your kids. You don't have to rebel. You don't have to let sin destroy your home. You can resist. You can fight. You can stand firm. You can repent. You can live in spiritual victory because the God that saved you through his Son, Jesus Christ, has also indwelt you with his Holy Spirit and given you his word, so you don't have to cave to the culture. Can stand on the truth. Christians are the only people on the planet that can actually resist sin because we have the Holy Spirit inside of us fighting for us and growing us to be more like Jesus. It doesn't mean that you can be perfect. It just means that you today don't have to be crushed and captured by the temptation that's coming your way. It means this, too, that there's hope for every marriage and every family and every home and for every kid that's walked off the map. There's hope in Jesus Christ. There's hope for your grandkids. There's hope for your home. There's hope because Jesus Christ not only died for your sins, but he walked out of the grave and he reigns right now. And we serve a living Savior, and you can cast your cares upon him and say, Lord, work in my family. It is a prayer he will always answer. And he will work because God is greatly glorified in the things he created. The heavens declare the glory of God, and so can your family. So how are things at home? How are things in your marriage? Has the enemy been successful in creating conflict in your house, in your heart, in your kids? What do? You look to Jesus, and you trust Jesus, and you pray to Jesus, and you fight for the glory of Jesus, and you repent of your sins to Jesus, and you decide today and every day that you're not going to let the evil one confuse you. You're going to stand on God's truth and live for the glory of Christ in your family. In your family. Let's pray together. Wayne's coming. We're going to close out with a song of invitation. And as we're doing that, it gives us a chance to think about the scripture. Not to think about the messenger, but to think about the message of the scripture. And to think about the truth that God is wanting to impress upon our hearts and to give us a chance to respond to it. And we respond with prayer and repentance and faith and trust. And so this morning, as we begin to sing, I want to invite you to consider what God would have you do with this message. Paul says in Romans 8, if God is for us, who can be against us? And there's a lot of truth in that. Your enemy is a defeated foe, but he's on a leash, but he still wreaks havoc against our homes. And this morning, for fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, I want to call you to prayer. To pray for your family and your marriage and your kids. One of the ways that might be appropriate for you is to come and just kneel at the front. and just say, Lord, here I am on my knees asking you to help me, to help me fight well for your glory in my home, for my marriage, maybe to repent of sin, and to say, Lord, we don't want the culture, we want the scripture to define who we are. And even if the entire world says that we're hateful and mean and small-minded and bigoted, we're going to stand with the God of this universe. It's possible you're here this morning and there's real problems in your family, real problems in your marriage. God can win and bring victory. And I want you to pray to that end, that this church would be known as a church of not just people that love each other, but families who are fighting for the truth of God in our homes. If you're here this morning and you're not a Christian, it's possible that maybe that's your situation. Maybe you grew up in church or walked away from it. This is a safe place for you to consider some things. And I just want you to know, we just as a church, we say this is the Bible. We're not perfect. We don't ask you to look to the church to make a decision about Jesus. We ask you to look to Jesus to make a decision about Jesus. And it's possible this morning that that's the greatest need of your life, is that your soul is right with God through faith in Jesus Christ. Whatever your need, whatever your response, I want you to follow the leadership of the Spirit as we begin to sing in a moment. I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to be standing down front like I do every Sunday to welcome you. If I can pray for you, if you're interested in joining this fellowship, it'd be a great day to do that. If I can minister to you in any way. But honestly, this time is between you and the Holy Spirit and the Word of God as you respond. Let's stand together and let me pray for us, and then we'll sing, and then we'll have a time of response. Father, we do thank you for your word on this Mother's Day. We thank you for our moms. We thank you for our families. We thank you for our children and our grandchildren, the blessings that are ours. And Lord, we recognize we're in a real battle, a real fight. And so, Lord, help us as moms and dads and grandparents and kids to take up the armor of God and to resist and to glorify you above all things. So, Lord, here's your text that we've studied and read, your message that you've given to us. And now, Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit gives us freedom to respond in a way that strengthens our faith and encourages our hearts and prepares us to live on mission for you. And we pray this now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, as we sing, you respond as the Lord leads, as Big Wayne comes to lead us.